in to the meeting that was Mike Moore last week, I mean, about two weeks ago.
So then, just about that. Okay, thank you very much. Any other items? No? Okay. So can we approve? Can this minutes be approved?
Yep. Three, three.
Thank you very much. So item number three, which is the Catalan updates. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. Chair, I'm not going to go through every header on this report. I am going to actually go speak, if okay by you, Chair, on item number five on the smart city. While it's not in the report, I just wanted to give an update, and I'm just conscious of time, but apologies to members. I need to leave at 10 to 7 because of childcare commitments. So I'll just give an update on the smart city. I'm happy to take any questions on anything in the report or as in my role as cabinet member. So the smart city is currently, it's a way of working, and being smart is not a goal, it's a way to help us achieve our goals. The important thing about us adopting a smart city approach is to ensure that we are adopting new ways of working that actually are focused on achieving the aims that we are setting out. If the real change for a smart city is understanding how we achieve our goals more effectively and for less money, with less environmental impact, it is not about being the first to adopt and use the newest technologies. The council is currently developing a new city plan, which is building on the inclusive growth plan, that will be wider in its scope, in that it will be more fully engaged with our partners in the public, private, voluntary and community sectors. The city plan will not only be owned by the council, but by all key stakeholders across the city. And as such, it provides the greatest opportunity for us to consider genuinely what our smart city priorities will be as part of incorporating it into the city plan going forward. So once the city plan is completed next year, it will provide the framework for the city to and its partners behind which a smart city delivery approach can be embedded. And I've asked that consideration be given across the developing themes of the smart off the plan to bring this back to, and I will bring this back to select committee for scrutiny and further consideration. The smart city approach previously taken by the council was led by my predecessor, Councillor Jim Hoakes, who was very passionate about incorporating the smart city approach. But we are taking a fresh look at this and what it actually means for us as a city, and we're incorporating that into the city plan. And just also happy to take any questions.
So you'll be dealing with item number five then as well at the same time as the
cabinet.
So there's a bit of time there. Thank you very much. Any questions? Councillor Trump.
Thanks, Chair. Sharon, could you talk a little bit about the plans for Brownway Hill? Because you do mention it in your cabinet report, you mentioned the Appendix of pedestrians and cyclists, which is obviously welcome. The pictures I've seen, they don't show any segregated cycleway, it's just a kind of, it's just marked out flat, isn't it? Could you just detail what facilities there are looking for cyclists on that road?
For the Brownway Hill scheme, I actually visited site and spoke to local residents and actually met with local councillors. There isn't a segregated cycle lane, but there is cycle provision as part of that scheme. If it helps, you can share the plans on what's, you know, past we've had some key things happen across the city, which was led by Councillor Luke's doing a fantastic job. We've got the opportunity to now to actually look, take some time and see what, you know, decide what our objectives are in delivering a small city. But it can mean a whole host of things, and it's an opportunity for us to actually look again at what we want to deliver.
Can I just, when you say we, who's we?
Council.
As he has mentioned, obviously that there needs to be a kind of a process of participation and consultation with the public throughout, especially if you're thinking about something so big as Smart City, City of Liverpool.
The city plan, whilst that process is to go through a whole host of consultation, and that's with partners, stakeholders, residents, so it forms part of that plan now.
Item number four, which is regarding the scrutiny panel. I think we're expecting a report to come back into.
Scrutiny panel is the recommendations being led completely by the councillors, three of us here. Richard Kemp is on that as well, it's a cross party one. We've got stuck by the PERDEF rules. So we're now out the other end of the election, and that will be picked up and reported back into the February one. You can hold me to that, Tom. And that will. So I will get around those recommendations, double check them with you, and then we work it back from there.
Fantastic, thank you very much. Can we lock that and put the date up to it as well for the next meeting, please? Item number six, which is the section 106 report, and can I invite the officers to introduce this report?
Thank you, Chair. This is a new report before this committee. This is a report that normally goes before neighbourhoods, but we thought in terms of transparency and consistency that you as a group would also like to see what I think is a positive report. These are new reports that are starting to come through now that we've got the governance in place for the Section 106 subcommittee, whether it's then reported to Cabinet, where we agree the spend. That isn't held with my department. This is a collaborative report with communities. So Ron Adonai's team, Christina Williams, so she spends the money, whereas I collect the money. So it's a collaborative report for the two portfolios. So the report's split into three parts. You'll see that the first part is it's a quarterly report, so it's an update. The first part of the report gives you an update in terms of the Section 106 contributions, what's been delivered, what's been collected. The second part is the minutes of the subcommittee that I've just referred to, and they are reported for information purposes to Cabinet, because it's a subcommittee of Cabinet. And then the third part of the report, you'll find Section 106 invoicing activities, so that's where it's outstanding collection that my department are working with. So some are outstanding, some have been invoiced, some have gone to debt collection. I'm happy to say, I can take through the report if you wish, but I'm happy to take questions on it. As I say, it's fairly self-explanatory. The first part introduces what we've done over the last quarter, or Christina's team fundamentally leading on that work. And then the minutes of the tableized group of projects that were agreed at the committee in the summer. So what can catch up with this committee? We've had two more subcommittee meetings since the minutes of this meeting, so they'll be coming to you now regularly in terms of consistency with the other select committee.
Councillor Rowe.
Yeah, can you tell me how long the process takes for us to recover money for 106 when basically the bid invoiced and then basically they're refusing to pay, because at the end of the day, this is what backs a lot of community projects, and this is also what comes back in relation to us being able to reinvest within our communities. So how long does the proof, or how long is my period to we give them as a leeway in collection?
A Section 106 agreement will have certain time scales in which to pay the relevant monies. Normally, it'll be, there's a monitoring fee, there's a number of collection items on it, so there's a monitoring fee, there's the actual setting up fee for legal services, that's paid on completion. There's also 50% up front, and then 50% on start of the scheme. So it depends when the scheme's being started. A normal planning permission is 3 years in which to commence, so we may only have 50% of part of the contribution, but then we will collect the other 50% when they commence development. It depends on the time frames of which we set within those Section 106 agreements. The list that you have before you are the ones that haven't been paid, so that can vary. So it depends, it's referred to debt collection after that. That's something that I couldn't give a time frame on.
Just to come back on that, where we've got projects that we know we've actually forced to close because of emergencies and bills and banks, etc., etc. So do we just lose that money off then, or are we able to sort of compensate it on sales back? So if there are projects where they've been built out, that moved in, then we've sort of gone back and we sort of had to close them down through a vacancy.
Yeah. I mean, Andy's just reminded me, Fox Street is an example of that. So we have a charge on the property where we require them to pay even though it's failed. Your first question, apologies, the list probably isn't explicit enough, but they're banded. So if you have the value 500,000 to a million, so everything that sits with that or below it is the value, and then that's as you go down. So the large majority on this list are 25,000 to 50,000 if they fit within that band. I don't have that information, unfortunately, in terms of the debt collection. I can get that for you and report back to committee.
Councillor Connor.
process that we charging people for, yeah? Do we link that up with the history of people paying or not paying Section 106 money, and can we? And can we keep a record on top of that with any developers, which I'm sure we can do as well, and in terms of the spend that we as a council, so if you just look at Fox Street, we've already spent £355,000 already on securing that site to make sure that the residents that were there, who shouldn't have been there, were kept safe with the 24/7 security there. We've already spent about £17,500 on replacing the pavement, as Andy knows, because I hassled them so much about that, to keep residents safe who were walking in the middle of the road because of what the developers were doing. Councillor Rose's point before, at what point do we say to people, you haven't paid your Section 106 monies, therefore we're going to make you wait in the queue? We can't stop them putting in planning applications, but we don't give them preferential treatment even if they pay for it for their pre-planning work. In terms of dates, so if you look down on page 45, we've got Fox Street was 2015 and 14 referring to. The site at the corner of Islington and Norton Street, which that student was over now. If you look further into the Section 106, we're actually greening some of that areas around the fabric district, which is just at the back of that block that hasn't even given us our Section 106 monies. You've also got it, so that's the fourth one down. You've also got it at 33 Down Street, which is again on the site of the fabric district. You've also got things like right near the end, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 off the bottom, got the former Derby Cinema, and that was 2011 and they still haven't paid their Section 106 monies. My understanding is that we need to check that actually that hotel which it is has even planning permission to act as a hotel. So what I'm trying to push for is that we look at every single, we don't have silos within the planning department. So I understand what you're saying, Sam, before about you put the money out and Christina spends it. But actually we need to have that conversation together so we can lock that down and say to people, hang on a minute, you're paid for this, you're expecting us to green the area, or looking at the and that's how we're greening the area. That's one thing.
Thank you, Jane. There's a lot there. Can I take that away and then answer properly to Jane in writing, and obviously I can report back to committee. In terms of that collaborative working, absolutely, very much so. This report's written by my team, but it's actually Christina's projects. We're working very, very close. We've employed two Section 106 officers in last year, and they're very much working closely together across the two portfolios. And they're both led by Andrew Dimber, who leads the team, is working closely with debt collection and finance. So that collaborative work is actually starting to work far better now. Hence, this information that's for you today.
Everton Islington Corridor, key seed production sites. It says cross Sycorham Park and Holden Hall Park. Can we make sure that the historical ones have got that understanding of it actually keeping with that, and that we don't lose that? And can I just say thank you, really, play areas, because Everton are getting a lot of play areas, and so we should. But we're going to do, we're making sure that I pull together a group, including a group that understands disability in a way that others don't in the city. And we're working with Northside Prime as well, so that some of those areas will be specifically high quality, completely accessible to every child, regardless of whether they have disability or not. So that would be lovely to use one of those as an example and roll that out across the city. So we don't have people having to tap it onto it to make it accessible. It is fully accessible to everyone. Enough said, so that's on.
I'm more than happy to meet with Jane and the team, both Christine Williams, myself, and Andrea Dinmore, and we can discuss the issues there. Right?
Come on, Ray. My question is really about the 106 and how long we've been running for. It's been running for some time as a structure, and I think normally what people not understand on occasions what it's for or where it can be spent. Are we at any time in the future going to be looking at this process in terms of reference? Because although it's a national type of thing, local authorities carry it out, we are, I'm sure, persuaded by the central government what we should do and how we should do it. But it's impossible that sometime in the near future we as a local authority start looking at it, because some people actually believe that the 106 was raised, for example, by Everton, because of what they've built, the money can only be spent there, and money can be spent on. But there's a lot of confusion, and beyond that, what I can gather, that how we can use it has changed over the years, especially from government and our sort of carriers. So is it possible for us to, in future, be looking at this, and waiting for today's, I want to say?
Yeah, you're right. This is a central government, or it's legislative set out within the Planning Act. We have very little flexibility of changing that Planning Act, but we can adopt local policy in terms of implementing Section 106. Currently we have Section 106 that allows for, a residential development should provide open space. Where it cannot provide the necessary open space, then they provide some monies in lieu of that provision. We also have an ask for street trees with residential development and major development, and we also have some monitoring fees. We have some revenue fees also for public art and the city model. So that's currently our policy. That's all we can collect for at this time. I am actually setting up a working group to see, we've just done a quick audit to see what other core cities particularly use Section 106 for. But it has to be evidence-based and it has to be linked to planning and policy. We can't just whimsically decide what we collect Section 106 for. And if you look on page 21 of the report, there's three points, there's three legal tests in order to collect Section 106 which need to be met. It's very stringent in terms of what can be collected and what it can be sent on.
Maintaining existing trees, volume of space, etc. However, can we put in collectively across the city and hold a contingency fund or a long-term maintenance fund? So where we're putting in new trees, where we're putting in wildflowers, where we're putting in whatever it is, could we actually hold a maintenance pot long-term, or is that not allowed?
Section 106 is a capital fund, not a revenue fund, so it's a car we use for maintenance, and that, I would say that would be an issue for Lonsdale.
But there is an issue about how you define capital versus revenue that is part of the capital. So there may still be a... Can we look at that in detail? Because you can actually get a maintenance stream within the capital that would normally be regarded as revenue, but actually can then go to capital.
I'll take that away and speak with
them. Any other questions? Okay. I have a few questions.
288,000 plus the 269, and that is to plant 670 trees, if that is correct, and the maths is right, then that means per tree we're paying 832 per tree. Isn't that a bit excessive for per tree, although we only charge £400 per tree per developer?
And what age of the trees?
I'm not an expert in terms of tree planting, but as I say, this comes from Christine's team, and that would be an average depending on what other trees, that the utilities in the road. So it can't be averaged as that's what the tree costs. It's actually the cost of actually putting the tree in the public realm, I would say. But I can get some further information on you from you for you on that.
Can that be published as well, please?
Yeah. Sure. Go on, Councillor Kerr, come back in.
Sorry, I'm page 85, still then Stafford Street Fabric District. I think we should hold back for now if we can on that and Islington area if they're actually crossing over until the student accommodation on the corner of Islington and Norton Street pays up their section 106 and say to them collectively, they meet together on the fabric district and say, listen guys, you have paid yours, we're waiting to put the trees in and we're going to put a maintenance budget in there as well.
Chair, can I suggest we just take that back to the Water Safe Group and have a report?
Thank you.
One of the things that I would have wanted within this report as well, since you're taking it, is and more details on ward collection. So where is it going to be? Where is this 106 collected from? Where is it going to be split? And a kind of a picture of balance. Is it really being spent in the right kind of areas where it's truly impacting, or are we just spending it somewhere else? I know legally we are restricted, I know that, but how much of that area do we go out of that? And
what you just said, Jane, and what we said before, I've gone the way myself, and what is clear is that a lot of authorities throughout the country now, I'm not trying to say they've broken the rules, but they've bent them to the extremity now where they've yet to break, because they've looked at different ways of doing this and how we should do it, and it seems to be very, very good ones of what they're doing. Now, all I was saying to you before, and it's what Jane says on board the bottom, whether or not it's about time we really looked at what we do and how we do it, bring it up to date and make sure what we're doing is the best way of spending the resources that we're getting, because we're getting done. So it isn't really to say what we're doing is wrong, but it is a long time since we looked at how we do something, and as someone once says, if we don't move, it's stagnation. Stagnation is a bad thing. So a lot of the issues we're looking at have been made by members over the time. All the local authorities don't need to reinvent the wheel. They're doing something good and we can adopt it. I think it's just something I'd like to share for us to take back, I mean, for our officers now to look at, of should we be looking at a new way of terms of reference and what we do and how we do. It makes it easier for all of us.
Can I just come in? Yeah, what I meant by that as well is when I'm looking at splitting as well, we're spending our own money here as well. So again, where I want it is to start planting trees when another development should have been planting the trees themselves in there. And then that frees us to kind of look, once we've got this map, it frees us up to say, right, okay, this ward has added it because due to the areas not being developed, or you can't have big buildings that do warrants 106. So focusing it on that angle. So what's that?
Chair, no problem to all those points. We need to take the opportunity to take the right angle. I suggest that, you know, the section 106 policy and what the authorities do, maybe some benchmarking as part of the next municipal year's work programme, to give us the opportunity just to take a look at that, reflecting on Councillor Clapton's comments, which are all well made and have been noted by voice
and my final comment is that, again, with regards to page 45 of the spending, again, I'd like it to be split in terms of, I know you've split it into category, but really it doesn't tell us how much exactly, and it doesn't tell us what stage. job are they in? So, and then you said there is a set money first and then a 50% and so on. I'd like that to be more translated on here in terms of, so we know exactly, we're not just saying, well, first one owns us 1 million when it's not true, it's probably left as well as paid half and so on.
Thank you, Chair.
Any other comments? Any? Okay, then we move to note the report and ask them to come back with a more full report. We're on 106 first. So we note their information and we're asking for the long list of other things. Okay.
Thank you.
Great, thanks. So now scheme of delegation, which is item number 7 in page 46 to 48. Any questions? Okay. Councillor Sharon.
Just an explanation here, it's on page 48, please. It says here payment to the Poseidon Foundation to offset carbon usage. 83,795, which is a lot of money. So, what are we doing? We are just offsetting carbon usage, paying for it, and therefore being carbon positive, as it says here. Yes, but that's, is this how we're going to be zero carbon? Is this the idea? To offset carbon payments?
So page number 48, the third column down. In the supplementary agenda.
Very quickly, at the bottom of page 47,
says there's a sign off for up to half a million maps for provision of highways and prevention treatment. I'm worried slightly about that because that means that it's a sign off that we will pay, please can we sign off as much as we can before it has to go to cabinet. That's why the 500,000 is there. Yeah, I presume. Once it's over 500,000, it has to go to cabinet. So I'm just asking for us to be careful on that because if a massive, great delegated decision sign off is done like that, we can miss actually trying to work out what is happening across the city in terms of this particular one, which is high rate of payment. It may be easy to do it that way, but perhaps more south or central or something.
Chair, just come back on that. It was a contract that was already awarded, just additional works that have been carried out that were provided for in the contract. And the contract so it was additional works that were needed, so since the delegation was an existing contract already procured and awarded.
But you wouldn't normally have a scheme delegation that vague for up to half a million pounds, would you?
Chair, happy to take Councillor Corbett through the detail of the work that's been done, the reasons why the delegated report was carried out, and I'll do that with the team. You can just set it out of exactly what was done, why it was done, where it was done.
No, I don't want that, Andy. I'm trying to use distraction. What I'm just saying is, can we just make a point that to just have a delegated decision sign off for half a million? All I'm saying is, can we just keep our eyes on that so we don't end up having more up to maximum half a million? That's what I'm saying.
Yes.
Okay, thank
you. Councillor Glenn.
Thank you, Chair. Is there a maximum amount that's allowed on the delegated pounds for that estate? And if you're making a decision on delegated pounds on the non-expenditure, is that shared with the cabinet member or is it just shared with the officer group?
I suppose it depends what it is. Anything that's over half a million has to go to cabinet, but that's not to say that the items that have been over half a million don't go to cabinet. There's a scheme of delegation that's set out in the constitution, and often the scheme of delegation is needed ensure pace, but those issues are discussed with the cabinet member and are discussed and the reasons for that, you know, set out.
I was just asking, is there a maximum that's allowed to stand up on the delegated powers? That's what it is, or isn't it? I was just asking, it used to be, I'm just wondering if it's still there.
Up to half a million.
Up to half a million, yeah. And for any of those payments, are they actually shared with the political side of the country? They're shared. If you're going to throw five or six items on the delegated powers, will they be shared with the cabinet member so that they're happy and they know what's happening? Because it covers you with nothing else.
Yes, I'll agree.